A little late, so we'd like to keep to the schedule. I would like to invite soon Hillel Mali to give a lecture. He is a PhD student in Bar-Ilan University, writing under Professor Aaron Shemesh, to whom we extend our best wishes for health. He's writing on the description of the wishes is for Professor Aaron Shemesh, right? The description of the temple in the Mishnah, history, reduction, and meaning. That's his dissertation topic, PhD topic, and I would like to invite you, please.
Okay, good morning. Before I will start, I want to thank you to Professor Esti Eshel and Aaron Meir and Angelica, because for me it's a very valuable opportunity to share my interpretation to Aramaic Levy document, and mainly to get your criticism, note, and help in this research. So I'm a little bit excited because this is my first lecture in the conference like this, so be kind. I would like to introduce you to the possibility of connecting two written compositions whose origins are in two different worlds. On the one hand, the Aramaic Levy document that was written in Aramaic and dated by most scholars to the 3rd or early 2nd century BCE, and on the other hand, the Tractate Tamid, a work written in Hebrew and included in the Mishnah, which was redacted circa 200 CE. And yet there are several similarities between these two sources that in my mind raise the possibility that Tractate Tamid and Aramaic Levy belong to a similar genre of instruction manuals for priests in the temple. First, I will present in brief the two treatises, and then I will discuss the laws of Aramaic Levy in more detail, offering a new interpretation of their internal structure and the way these laws are connected to each other. Finally, I will analyze the relationship of the two texts. I want to say in the beginning that my main purpose is to interrupt Aramaic Levy document not as a segment of instruction that have no relation to each other apart, aside of this connection to the priesthood, but as a narrative ritual, as something that describe a procession of the priest into the temple and sacrificial here. And so let's begin. The Aramaic Levy document is a treatise that deals with the life of Levi, son of Jacob. In this narrative, which includes prayer, journeys, and visions, there is one long unit, about one third of the treatise that we possess, which consists of halachic instruction relating to the priestly service in the temple. The narrative frame that contains these instructions is the encounter between Yitzchak, a grandfather who meets his grandson Levi, who is a priest of the Most High God, and instructs him in the general laws relating to his as a priest and the order of the temple service. There are two good reasons, as we just heard from Dan and the others, from Henrik Dornel and Michael Stone and Esti Eshel and other research, that caused several scholars of the Aramaic Levy document to define the work as an instruction manual for priests in training, a handbook of the temple. First, the frame story has a pedagogical tone. The literary framework of grandfather speaking to his grandson is fitting very well and proper for a book of instruction, and the character of Levi, the patriarch of the priestly tribe, matches the portrait of the ideal priest who receives instruction and implements it. Along with this, and maybe more important, a large part of the laws is practical and concrete. The unit contains extensive treatment of the priest's quantities of salt, fine flour, and wood required to perform each sacrifice. There is no parallel in the Torah or in Second Temple literature for such a description, although its practical importance for the priest who wants to salt the inner organs of the animals is clear. We wish to focus on the unit of instruction to the priest, which appears under the hidden Rukdi Adadi Ana Kahenda El Elyon Lemare Shemaya Sharel Fakadati Velalfayati Dinke Anuta. The priestly law begin with the priest's obligation to sanctify himself by removing himself from all forms of impurity, and moves on to the various instructions pertaining to the temple service itself. The unit dealing with the temple service begins with three verses about the priest's obligation to sanctify himself when he comes to the temple. The second part deals with the type of wood permitted to be sacrificed on the altar, and the third deals with offering the sacrifice itself. Researchers of the Levi document saw the various sections of the unit as discrete segments, a collection of instruction without any direct connection between them, and thus no special importance to their order. Similarly, they understood that the sacrifice described in the third unit is a whole offering burnt by the individual, as described in Leviticus chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. In contrast to this view, I believe that we are not looking at a collection of instruction, but rather at a sequence of instructions, a narrative that is a chronological step-by-step description of the priest's work in the temple. I would like to propose further that reading of the unit sequentially, as well as several details of the halachot, shows that the subject here is the daily communal whole offering of the morning, rather than the individual whole offering. The unit of instructions begin with the description of the priest entering the house of God. The description of his entry is accompanied by three instructions relating to purification, constructed with the same syntactical structure. The various structure, you can see it in the first line, second line, and third line, have a same uchditi have kaim lemea lebet el have sachi b'maya uchditi have lavish have taiv tuv urchi ayadach v'raglach. So the various purification directives are not separate instructions that relate to three different situations. They are three instructions in sequence that describe the process whereby the priest purifies himself. First, the priest enters the temple, therefore he must immerse himself. Second, he puts on the priestly garments. And third, he approaches to the altar. The Levi document links the instructions so that the second instruction repeats the ending of the first, and the third repeats the ending of the second. In other words, and this is very important for me, the legal command in Exodus chapter 30 about the priest's obligation to purify themselves when they come to the tent of meeting and when they approach to serve at the altar becomes, in the Levi document, a continuous and broken narrative process where the priest enters the temple, dons his ritual garments, and approaches the altar, while between this action he is purified. I want to explain a little bit. I hope that my English will be good enough. Exodus said that the priests that enter to the temple have to wash, and the priests that approach to the altar have to wash his hands and feet. And Leviticus 16 give another instruction concerning the priest that put on his garments. So what Levi document do in this section, if I understand it correctly, he took three different various instructions from different places in the Bible and transform them to one narrative that speak about the priest entering, put his garment, approach to the altar. And I think that literally when the Aramic Levi document repeats about the words that end the first verse and the end the second verb, he gives you a feeling of something that continuous, unbroken process. The second instruction, to immerse himself, adela tikrav lemidbecha kol dena, has two possible interpretations. Greenfeld understood that the word tikrav is an intransitive verb which refers to the person, and therefore he translated it as a before thou approach the altar at all. On the other hand, Charles understood the word takriv as a transitive verb whose object is the offering, and therefore he translated it as before thou offer anything on the altar. I am convinced that Charles in translation is the better translation. Firstly, the Greek translation proto engison ton bomos prosenokei olokrapusin support his reading. Secondly, in Exodus, the approach to the altar which includes purification is a purposeful one. Lesharet leaktir ishe lehashem, to minister, to burn an offering made by fire to the Lord. Finally, we have seen that the beginning of verse 2 repeats the ending of verse 1, while the beginning of verse 3 repeats the ending of verse 2. If so, and if I correct in this point, so the הדלת תקרב למטבח הכל דנה, is equal to להקרבה כל די חזל להנסקה למטבח הסור. The both instruction deal with purification before approaching to the altar and not before approach the altar without sacrifice. The question facing us, and this is the main question of the first part of the lecture, is which sacrifice is the priest required to offer, the communal offering or the individual offering? All the researchers of Levy document, among them Lawrence Schiffman, Robert Kugler, Henrik Drounel, Greenfeld, Stone, Eschel, and the other scholars, in their his edition, interpreted it to mean the text is referring to the sacrifice service of the individual whole offering. What Stone and Greenfeld and Eschel did, they understood that this is a specific unit that deal with individual whole offering, and because of this interpretation, they separate this unit from the other part of the instructions. So there is a part of the instructions that deal with purification. After this, you speak about sacrificial, and after this, you speak about something else. I will attempt to propose that, in fact, the sacrifice and the entire unit is referring to the communal offering, not the individual offering. The accepted position is based primarily on one very good proof. When the Levy document described the order of the sacrifice, animals, organs that must be placed on the altar, it states that ראש אהב ומאנסק לקדמין ועלו איכה פטרבה ולהתך זה לדם נכסת תורה. Namely, the priest is required to cover the animal's head with fat so that he will not see the blood of the slaughtered bull. If so, this is referring to the individual whole offering that may be brought of cattle and not the daily offering which is brought from the sheep. However, the version that mentions the bull is a little bit problematic. In the Greek translation, the wording appears thus, kaimea ptonoste toaima epites kephales autes, and as Greenfield translated it, and the blood not be seen on its head. According to this wording, there is no explicit mention of which animal is being discussed. The verses that deal with placing the organs on the altar were preserved only partially in 4Q 214, that you can see it in the slide, where in line 4 it is written ve'alit chaze, and in line 5 is written uvatrahan yadaya. In order to assume that the text contained the view that nichsat Torah, we must fill in a fairly long blank as compared to the completion of the line next to it. The Gniza text also requires clarification because in the Gniza version it is written dam nasbat Torah. The meaning of the word nasbat is not clear, and the editors corrected, for a good reason, is to nichsat Torah, slaughtered bull. If so, mention of the bull is questionable, and even if the text is the original, it may be explained, as my teacher, Professor Aaron Shemesh, may God send him refuah shlema, as a side note that explained the general law that require covering the neck. In order to determine what was the nature of the sacrifice described, we must first understood the nature of the extended instruction about lighting the fire on the altar. According to the instruction that explained the entire unit as dealing with the individual whole offering, we have before us the description of a ritual that was carried out before any sacrifice was offered. While according to the interpretations that I will propose, the subject here is the lighting the altar in the morning when bringing the daily whole offering at dawn. The Torah mentioned the ritual of lighting the altar twice, once at length in Leviticus 6, in relation to the subject of the daily communal whole offering, where it was written that the fire must be lit on the altar baboker, baboker, early in the morning. And another time in Leviticus 1, as part of the individual whole offering service, it is written that the priest will put fire on the altar and arrange the wood above the fire. The scholars who interpreted Aramaic Levy as referring to the individual whole offering based the reading on the parallel to Leviticus 1. However, this interpretation is very problematic for two reasons. First, I discovered, as Jonathan Sagiv showed, all the scribes of the Second Temple period shared something very interesting. In Leviticus 1, when the Torah described the process of bringing the individual whole offering, there is two verses that speak about lighting the fire. But the Temple Scroll, the New Jerusalem Scroll, Philon from Alexandria, Josephus Flavius, as well as the sages after them, this is a very, very rare consensus. I can't imagine something like this in the disagreement about what is the halakha in the Second Temple period. All of them shared one interpretation. There is no fire in the bringing of the individual whole offering. And I think that this rare consensus between all the halachic system in the Second Temple period, so different, Alexandria, Israel, Temple School, New Jerusalem, is caused because one very simple reason. Bring fire to the altar is not a trivial thing. Bring fire, the fire that burning upon the altar is something that symbolizes the divine presence, the acceptance of the sacrifice, the God appearance in the temple and the accept his. This is a thing that is an essential part of the temple. You do it in the morning and not before any bringing of sacrifice. I guess that this is the reason why all the scribes in Second Temple period ignore the verses from Leviticus 1 that deal with the fire, because they understood these verses as something that connected to the morning offering. Milgram himself, in his commentary on Leviticus, offer, and I have no the background, the linguistic background, so to judge what he said, I just can quoted him. But Milgram said maybe this is the meaning of the verses himself, because they change their little bit change when they speak about the giving the fire. So they ignore the verses that speak in the fire, because they all shared not just the same interpretation about the process of bringing the individual whole offering, but they all share the interpretations that connect the fire to some very special moment in the morning when you bring a fire to the altar. So I think that if you want to interrupt Aramic Levy document as a unit that deal with specific sacrifice, you have to say that he is an splendid isolation between all the system in the Second Temple period. And if you will say that we don't know, I just learned from Dan about what is the Aramic movement and literature, okay, you will tell me that the Aramaic Levy document maybe have a different halakha from the other system, even though you have a different difficulties, because the order in the Leviticus 1 is first, sorry about speaking about sacrifice and blood, I hope that it's fine. The order in Leviticus 1 is to slaughter the bull, and just then, you bring the fire. So if you delete these verses, you have no problem. You delete these verses and ignore the verses that speak about the fire, is everything okay? If we want to argue that Aramaic Levy document understood the verses in chapter 1 of Leviticus as a face value, we need to say that he have to follow after this order. But the order in Aramaic Levy document is first lighting the altar and then sacrificed the bull. So I convinced, and I hope that you also, I convinced that we must understood Aramaic Levy document as speaking about the ritual of the morning lighting the fire. You know, Josephus named the whole offering as a offering that connect to the fire. You bring the sacrifice as part of the lighting the altar. And if you will read the Aramaic Levy document, you will see he speak about the fire and the sacrifice together. Now I need to find myself after I have the courage to speak. Okay. One moment. Okay, I am convinced that this interpretation has several other literary advantages. The description of an entering the temple, the immersion, and the donning of the garments is a description appropriate for the beginning of a workday and not of a particular act of sacrifice. A priest will not enter the temple to sacrifice one sacrifice or another, but to perform his service as part of the temple workday, a day that begins at dawn with lighting the fire on the altar and sacrificing the daily offering. Indeed, the description of donning the priestly clothes actually appears in the biblical account on the daily communal whole offering, where it is written, one moment, Tzavet Aharon ve'et banav lemor zot Torat ha'olah. I jump, ולבש הכהן מידו בד, ומכנס לבד ילבש על בשרו, הרים את הדשן, ויער עצים בבוקר. This is the same order that we find in Aramaic Levy document: clothes, sacrifice, wood, lighting the altar. So this chapter, as opposed to the chapter on the individual daily whole offering, is addressed to the priest and not to the people. Its title is whole offering, but its subject is lighting the fire. In other words, sacrificing the communal whole offering and lighting the fire come together. If so, the priest, the clothes, the focus on lighting the fire, the chronological relation between the act of lighting and the act of sacrificing, the interweaving of arranging the wood and offering the sacrifice, all of this correspond well with the morning service. Indeed, it makes sense that in the Atuites instructing the priest in his work, the subject should be a regular order of work in the temple, the daily whole offering, which is the task of the priest, and not instruction for the one individual whole offering. If we are right, then Aramaic Levi and Tractate Tamid have a common theme. Both deal with the morning service, which includes igniting the fire and other preparation and sacrificing the daily whole offering at dawn. And before I will start the main point, I want to be very zahir, very careful. I talk a lot with my teacher, Dr. Yair Forstenberg, that sitting here, and he helped me a lot. And Professor Menachem Kister is here. So I don't want to say that Tractate Tamid came directly or something like this from Aramaic Levy document. I don't know enough about the Aramaic literature and the connection, the possible connection between this literature to the sages. But what I want to say is, if the interpretations that I just offered to Aramaic Levy document is correct, so we have two different treatises that speak about the same ritual in the morning in the temple. And Tractate Tamid, as we just as we will speak about it in one moment, defined by Ginsburg as an archaeological relic in the Mishnah. Maybe, and we will check it immediately, this is not a regular sages composition. So I want to show some very gentle similarities between these two treatises and to offer some connection between them, and maybe you will find the answer that explain the disconnection. But before we will do it, first a few words about Tractate Tamid. Any sensitive reader of Tractate Tamid will admit that it is very ancient. This is how Rabbi Nachman Krochmel, some 150 years ago, characterized Tractate Tamid. Indeed, as part of the effort to identify the source from which the Mishnah is composed, Tractate Tamid always had a special place. The language of the Tractate, as shown by Ginsburg, Epstein, and Barasher, is older and different than the rest of the Mishnah. The halachot and the laws listed in Tractate Tamid, they are mostly anonymous and without a dissenting opinion. Given the fact that debate is a fundamental characteristic of rabbinic literature, it raises the question of whether Tamid was composed as part of the Tanaitic academies in Israel after the destruction of the temple, or perhaps it has a different historical origin. The style of the Tractate is narrative as opposed to legal, and sometimes the language is almost poetic. For these reasons, Ginsburg contended that it is an archaeological, I very like this definition, as an archaeological relic that was frozen and retained its form in the Mishnah, hardly touched by editors. The hypothesis raised by Krochmel regarding the antiquity of Tamid, which was further developed by Ginsburg and elaborated by Epstein, came under criticism in the 17th. Talmud scholars like Neusner and Bloomberg and other today noted that the rhetorical and linguistic characteristic of the Tractate could be seen not an indication of the archaeological stratification of the Mishnah, but rather of the diversity of rhetoric used by its authors. In other words, the archaic language might be a rhetorical device suited to describing the temple ceremonies and not an indication to the date of which the Tractate came from. The uncertainty surrounding the issue of dating prevents an understanding of the question of context and purpose in Tamid. Tamid, as defined by the Rambam himself, is the story about, I read from Mishneh Torah, story about how the daily offering was made, and perhaps it is better defined as a story that deals with the temple service at dawn. Now, is this story a halachic treatise, a historical record of the temple service? Or do we have a descriptive narrative based on Midrashim, on the Torah laws of the daily whole offering? And for what purpose was the composition written? Was it shaped in priestly circles for practical purposes? Or perhaps it is an ancient example of a, this is not very good definition, but a liturgical version of the order of the service that served as an alternative to the temple service that was lost. So some scholars offered that what is the origin of Tamid and Yoma and tractate like this? Jewish have not lost their temple. So they create a linguistic alternative to the temple. You cannot sacrifice sacrificial. So you speak about sacrifice. V'neshalma parim spatenu, as Shlomo Nae speak a lot about this phrase. You will pay your doubt to the God through your mouth and without a sacrifice. But maybe Tamid came from the temple, and maybe from other sources. We will now examine the relationship between Tractate Tamid and Aramaic Levi. Tamid has six chapters against the Dfus version. The first two deal with preparing the altar, the middle two with preparing the sacrifice, and the last two with bringing the sacrifice on the altar. The Tractate contains a story that begins with the priest sleeping near the temple. They awaken at dawn to their work. I have no time? 5 minutes? Okay, we'll slow it. It's good. Between Tamid and the Aramaic Levi document, there is some similarities. First, the first connection connected to the structure. They both begin with preparing the priest. They both proceed to the preparing the sacrifice, and they both end with the sacrificial. The most interesting point is the mixture that I don't know another in a parallel in the Second Temple literature that mixed together instructions that related to the priest himself, immersion, purification, things like this, and instructions that related to the sacrifice. So the perspective of the two composition is the priest that work in the temple. The all the walls, I think. All the walls that appears in Aramaic Levi document appear in Tamid, in Tractate Tamid, and the order that important, that emphasized by Aramaic Levi documents is emphasized by Tamid Tractate. I just give one example: the order of the organs of the animal, the order to put chapetar ba'aloi tzavara appears twice in Tractate Tamid. So there is some similarities between the content and the structure. The opening of the two composition of the unit of the instruction in Aramaic Levi document and the Tractate Tamid is speak about the clothes, the impurity of the priest in the night and the entering of the to the temple. So another something very interesting is the formula of concluding the two composition. In Tamid it's written Zehu seder ha-tamid la'avodat bet elokenu yiratzon sheibane b'mera b'yamenu. Amen. And in the Aramaic Levi document, V'yavun ken ovadech beserech v'chol korbanech l'ra'ava l'reach nichoach kodem el elyon. They both spoke about the order, and because the things are made by order, so you wish that something happened, the sacrifice will accept to God. To, in the Greek translation is read To ergon su, To ergon su, I forget one word, taxi. So it will be seder, the equivalent to the Hebrew seder atamid. So it's there is some similarities between the opening, the ending, the content, and the structure of the two composition. I think, and this is the most interesting point, that there is evidence in the Mishnah that compositions like this, treatises like this, will exist in the temple and the priest use it. Before, in a very famous Mishnah, it read, "Masru lezkenim mizikne bedin v'korin lefanav beseder hayom." All the scholars are part of Epstein, and all the commentators are part of nothing. I look everywhere. Interrupt these words as referring to the Bible. What the elder read before the high priest is Parashat Achremot. But I think, if you will agree with me, that this is almost impossible. Seder X in the rabbinic literature, there is just examples that refer to a non-biblical treatises. This is one reason to understand that Seder Hayom is not referred to the Bible, but to the a pre-biblical composition, something that non-biblical composition. The second proof is when Tractate Yoma, and I don't know why other scholars not accept Epstein offer, because in Tractate Yoma, when the Mishnah wants to speak about Achrei Mot, it said Achrei Mot. The high priest read from Achrei Mot. So if in the beginning of the Tractate you speak about Seder Hayom, it means that this is not Achrei Mot, because this is a two different... And third, my teacher, Aaron Shemesh, said to me, it makes sense that when the priest want to educate, to instruct the high priest before his work, they will teach him something concrete, something updated to his work, and not something that took from the Bible, because the discrepancies between the biblical account on the Day of Atonement and the Mishnah. So, if the understanding of Seder Hayom is correct, the Mishnah speak about a written composition that speak about the order. And this is very close to the phrase that in Masechet Tamid, Zehu Seder HaTamid LaAvodat Bet Eloheinu. In the last page. One moment, okay. So, one moment, thank you. If these hypotheses are correct, then we have here a unique example of a special connection between the ancient priestly tradition from the Second Temple period and rabbinic literature, which was written hundreds of years later, in which case Tractate Tamid is in fact an archaeological relic of the temple in the Mishnah. And what I want to investigate, if you can help me and give a note and criticism, that these two, I cannot say about the... about the way that Aramaic Levi document made in Second Temple territory. I just say that the similarities in the content, in the halakha, in the structure, and the evidence that this genre war existed in the temple maybe help us to define also Aramaic Levi document and Tractate Tamid. So thank you very, very, very much.